This week, we discuss if the Flames' good start to the season created false expectations for the team, how the team looks after 20 games, how the coaching staff's handled Sven Berchi so far, and if Hartley, Feaster, the rest of the front office are the right people to be leading this team. Plus, Luke tries to get a kissogram funded, and a lot more. This is episode 29, Let's Fund a Kissogram, recorded November 18th, 2013.
Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat, featuring Dan, Matt, and Lucas.
It's Monday night, and we're coming off the Flames overtime, or I guess the Flames shootout win over the Jets, the 5-4 win tonight. And it's been a really interesting week for the Flames. And as usual, we're here to talk about it. I'm Dan, along with Matt and Luke. How you guys doing?
Very good.
Terrific.
So what are your thoughts on the game tonight, guys?
It was a bit of a slow start. We were having some difficulty getting past Winnipeg's defense, but once the game opened up a bit, it was very good.
Thoroughly enjoyable game. I only really saw the third period, but super entertaining. A lot of effort, a lot of hustle, back and forth action. Frustrating as that last second goal was, I thought they showed some good mental strength. They didn't back down. They didn't fold. And good for them.
As a Flames fan, I kept thinking, you know, as interesting and as fun as it was to watch, I kept thinking this team just can't get a break tonight. I mean, every time we'd score, the Jets would answer back with one. And it, you know, like you said, it's good mental toughness because it had to take some mental toughness to stay in the game when that's happening.
Oh, for sure. And given their recent collapses against the Oilers and that display against the Stars, I mean, and I guess even going back to the Wild game, it was good that they managed to tough out one of these shootouts.
So let's talk about that shootout quickly. We went 8 rounds, and we were talking before we went on the air tonight about if this is the longest Flame shootout in history. And Luke and I remember shootout, I think it was against the Wild a couple years ago. Maybe 5 years ago? Okay. And I think it went like 12 rounds. McLennan was in net, and I don't remember if nobody was scoring or everybody was scoring.
It felt like everybody was scoring, although this is a long, long time ago. This is probably what?
Like, I think it was like the first year or two of the shootout.
Yeah, it would have been like 2006, 2007, the Playfair year, because that was the only year Noodles came back after he was traded to New York, and he famously... Who'd he slash? Was it Franzen?
We
just hit him in the playoffs? Yeah.
I think he's still suspended for that, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
All good. Ugh.
So, yeah, it was exciting. I'm not a big fan of shootouts. I never have been. But I found tonight's to be exciting, and seeing the guys that were scoring, and I think having Monahan clinch the thing was a great end to this game. And I think this week, a rough week for the Flames. What do you guys think?
Oh, most definitely. And seeing both him and Colborne scoring in the shootout, especially that really dirty move by Colborne, you know, like, that's encouraging, because first, having so many years of our shootouts being extremely terrible, having some different options is a good thing. And plus, having Berra actually make a few saves, you know, it's a little bit of a departure from Kipper, who is, you know, somewhat inconsistent.
Well, I mean, Berra's approach in the shootout is so... It's 180 degrees from Kiprusoff's, which was basically make yourself as small as possible and shimmy backwards in a way that made it completely impossible for you to be able to do any one thing at any given moment. It was the worst shootout strategy in the league. Berra goes, you know, 8 to 12 feet out of his net, just gives them nothing, and then they've got to... You know, they've got to take the shot, or they've got to try and outweight him, but he's 6'3", and he's, you know, he's just long. Terrific. And the legend of Sean Monahan continues to grow.
The legend of Rito Barra, too.
Yeah, and Rito Barra's taken some heat from certain people on the internet, who I won't name names because, frankly, I don't know them or remember. But, I mean, people who'd say stuff like, Bear is not an NHL goaltender because he lets in that weak goal against Edmonton. Well, that's one that, okay, that's because Kiprusoff never gave up goals like that. Only he did lots because positionally and technically, as much as we lionize 34, there were moments where he would lose focus. And so, you know, Barra's been terrific. He really has.
Yeah, and with Barra, you know, he's coming over from Switzerland, still adjusting to NHL ice and all that. Like, he has all the tools to be a good starting goaltender. It's just he has to put all of them together, and he, you know, you can see plainly that he hasn't quite figured it all out yet. But he is getting a little bit better each game, and he's not over-committing on shots and such as he did initially. So, you know, it's a work in progress, but, you know, it's all part of the rebuild. You know,
the raw talent is there. He's just got to figure out his game at this level.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And you know what? He knows how to make big saves. He doesn't quit on plays. And you know what else? He's playing behind a defense that can only be described as ramshackle.
Yeah, that's about it.
It's a good way to put it.
Like, Brody, Schmid, Weidman, Russell, Butler, O'Brien, Smith. No Giordano in that group, which was not great to begin with. Are we expecting him to be, you know, a 34-year-old Tim Thomas here, or are we understanding that this is a guy who's played six games in the NHL, or seven, or whatever?
Well, if you look at his stats don't tell the story. I mean, he's played seven games, he has two wins, four losses, one overtime loss. His save percentage is .889, and his goals against average is 3.65. So he doesn't have the greatest stats out there, but I think every game he's starting to show more and more promise. And is that not what this year is about? Is this year not about grooming these guys and seeing who's got what it takes to be an NHLer?
Yeah, and yeah, with the goals that he is giving up, like a large quantity of them have been goals where he had absolutely no chance on. Like either he'd make the first and the second save and let the third one in, or, you know, like there'd be a breakaway where, you know, you either save it or you don't. You know, like he's only given up one truly stinker goal, and that was the third one against Edmonton.
And everybody gives up a bad goal once in a while.
Yeah, like the rest of them, some you wish you'd have back, but, you know, you can understand why he missed them. But, you know, like there's not been too many that, like, you can definitively say, like, that was really, really bad and all your fault.
And before anyone out there raises their hand and goes, the Jokinen goal tonight, that went through at least three people, at maybe four, at not more than 40 miles an hour. That shot was impossible.
Yeah, and it went off the post and in, like, yeah.
Do you guys think perhaps our view of goaltending and what people think is a good goalie is skewed because of Kipper?
Yeah. You know, we're used to, like, the great saves being a regular thing. And, you know, Barra has been getting some of those saves, but it's a little inconsistent. It's just that, you know, if your defense isn't helping at all, which for the a large part, the Flames' defense has been quite terrible. You know, there's only so much one guy can do.
Yeah. And I think that's the other thing, is we were used to Kipper saving games for us, and more often than not, he'd keep us in a game we had no business being in. And I think now we don't have a goaltender that can do that, and perhaps that's still what Flames fans are expecting our goaltender to do, and that maybe that's why people are talking down about him.
Well, the thing is that in the St. Louis and Colorado games, like, the Flames were out of it in terms of their on-ice play, but Barra definitely was keeping them in. You know, like, yeah, they didn't win, but, you know, they wouldn't have had any ability to make a late-game push like they did if it wasn't for him.
Oh, for sure. And I even think the notion that Kiprasov stole that many games for us, which he stole a lot, don't get me wrong. He was a terrific goaltender. But there was just that level of consistency and that ability to settle the team down that radiated from the crease when he was in net. And yeah, I think as fans we did get spoiled to that. It reminds me a lot, in fact, of Green Bay Packers fans right now are absolutely beside themselves because they're having to watch players play quarterback for them who aren't first ballot Hall of Famers. When you go from Brett Favre to Aaron Rodgers and, you know, guys who can just make magic happen with a football to some scrub who's trying to complete 50% of his passes on bubble screens, you're just like, what is this? And Cleveland Browns fans are going, this has been the last 30 years.
Now, what you're saying, though, about, you know, calming the players down, do you necessarily think that's a Kipper thing, or do you just think that's a veteran goalie thing?
I don't think it's a veteran goalie thing. I think it's a good goalie thing. I think any goalie who just, once you've got the confidence of your team, unless you do something really drastic to lose it, it's just sort of there. And it was always there with Kipper. Even when he was playing less than stellar at points last year, there were still lots of moments when the team just realized, oh yeah, we've got number 34 in net. It's going to be fine.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I'd go with that.
And yeah, like when you get accustomed to greatness, the heir apparent is, or not the heir apparent, the next in line is always going to disappoint you. To keep with football, whoever was the coach of the Calgary Stampeders after Wally Buono was never going to have success. You wanted to be the guy who replaced the guy who was a legend.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's probably a good way to put it. And, you know, I think we're lucky with Sean Monahan, because I think in many people's eyes, he's the replacement for the captain that we lost last year, and he's looking good so far. But yeah, I think you're right. Anyone that comes in and has to be that face of the franchise in various positions is going to be looked at through rose-colored glasses because they're being compared to the last guy.
For sure. And, I mean, with Monahan, by the way, his comparable has often been Jonathan Toews, but a lot of people going into the draft compared him to Eric Staal, and I'm seeing that more and more as he gets comfortable. And he's really sort of righted his ship. He had a rough stretch through parts of November, but he's looking a lot like a young Eric Staal right now.
Guys, we're just over 20 games into the season now, and we've said earlier in the season that after 20 games, you can probably really evaluate this team and where they sit. And I think it's not only 20 games in, but we're coming off a rough patch for the Flames. I mean, this is a team that couldn't even beat the Oilers this week. They had a lead, and they blew a lead against the Oilers. So 20 games in, how are you thinking the team looks? Matt, why don't you give us your thoughts?
It's more or less what I think most people, like if you listed out our wins and losses after 20 games, I think that's pretty much what everybody would have said. Yeah, that's about right. You know, like, there's, in any stretch, there's going to be ups and downs, and, you know, we're rebuilding. Like, it's disappointing that we're, like, 27th or whatever, but
do you think that we were perhaps spoiled by a good start and it might have set false expectations?
I think that's definitely a thing. You know, like, we did have better conditioning than a lot of teams, so we might have caught them off guard. But, you know, talent usually will win a hockey game for you. Like, that's part of the reason why the Flames won so many games the last 4 years. It certainly wasn't through effort. So, you know, we're seeing that we don't really have much talent on the ice, and the other teams just outwork and outplay us. Like, you know, it is what it is. Like, you know, you're rebuilding. You know, you don't have a starting goaltender, your defense is terrible, and you've got two or three top six forwards, and, you know, no bona fide star player to rely on. So, yeah.
Don't forget that your two best veterans are out for extended periods of time. Oh, and it is 20 games into a rebuild that everyone else in the hockey world was calling for 3 years ago. So, anyone who actually thought we were going to have this sorted out by Christmas, I'm sorry, you were wrong.
Yeah,
like, and it's not the team's fault. You're wrong. You're going to continue to be wrong, so chill out.
Yeah, like, this team is likely headed for a top five pick this year and is very likely to get another top five pick next year. You know, like, it's not going to magically, you know, turn over tomorrow. Like, you can't just insert, say, Gaudreau and Poirier and Jankowski and Gillies in the lineup and magically you're going to win a cup. You know, like, it takes time. And, you know, unfortunately, we're going to be pretty bad. And, you know, just look on the bright side. You're starting to see guys like Monahan do better. Berchi played a lot better tonight. Colborne's starting to figure some things out. So, you know, it's encouraging. It's just, you, like, the way I cope with it is that, like, I view it as, like, a season-long training camp where the wins and losses don't matter. It's how the players play. You know, I find that I don't get as pissed off when the Flames do lose or do blow a game, like the Edmonton game. You know, it just takes the edge off.
Yeah, I think that's a really good way to look at it. Going into this season, I've kind of made for myself a matrix of where I thought the team would be in relation to other teams at various points, and they're sitting about where I expected them to be at this point of the year. I think, Matt, you said it probably the best in that I think that we have to, as Flames fans, not necessarily look at the team's overall production, but look at the individual pieces and the progression there. Because this is a rebuild. And I think, you know, I was spoiled by the false start. I'll tell you that. I hoped this team was going to come out and do better than I thought. But they're not. They're doing exactly what I thought they'd do at the beginning of the year. And I think that, yeah, like, looking at some of these young guys like, you know, Rito Barra, TJ Brody, Monahan, Colborne, and seeing the way they're developing is promising. And I think that's what we have to be looking for this year.
Yeah. And even the last three games, despite the fact, I mean, I guess he's got 3 points, but Sven's been the best forward, far and away. There were the game before that, before the Dallas game, I think it was Minnesota, he had several plays where he just took the easy way out, did not contest the play properly, and I would have been furious with him if I were Harley. I was the most disappointed with him after that game that I think I'd been his entire Flames career, and I'm one of the most, I think, ardent Sven defenders you'll find. But the last three games, he's been really hard on the puck. He's been hard on the forecheck. He's just let guys know he's there. And aside from the Dallas game, where he passed up three great opportunities to shoot, he's been getting better and better. Oh, and just so we're clear, I will at this moment take the time to speak directly to Sven Berchi. Sven, on a 2-on-1, under no circumstances are you to pass the puck to McGrattan. You're just not. Shoot it into the defenseman before you pass it to McGrattan.
So, Luke, as a defender of Berchi, and I mean, I'm a big fan of his too, what do you make of the way that he's been handled by the coaching staff lately? A lot of people are upset by the fact he's been benched and he's gotten less play time.
I think people need to realize that the staff and management of the Calgary Flames know exactly who Sven is and what kind of person he is. And to me, their actions suggest not this. They're not trying to run him out of town. Their actions suggest to me that they have figured out the puzzle that is Sven Berchi, and they will make him into a better hockey player. They will make him into the hockey player we all want him to be and know he can be as a result of this course of action.
Everyone's motivated differently, and a good coach knows how to motivate everyone on their team, even if it's different than how they would other people, or even if it's unconventional. So I think you're right. They've finally figured out how to motivate Sven, for better or for worse, and all they're doing is using the tools and using the knowledge they have.
Yeah, and if you look back to Burke's old team, Toronto, right, how they treated Nazem Kadri would make, like, Flames fans all rip their hair out if we did the same to Berchi. You know, like, he's getting off light compared to what Kadri went through. And yet, look now at what Kadri is versus what he was 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when they were doing all this to him. So, you know, like, they'd send him to the minors, they'd bench him regularly, you know, and really give him a hard time to the point where you'd think he'd bust, but instead he turned it on and is one of their best players now. And I think that's what they're trying to do with Berchi, is to, you know, get him to do a certain level of play in order to actually become what he should be.
And they're not afraid to tell him, this isn't what we want to see, sit down, think about it, and we'll give you a chance to try it again, which I really admire.
And nor should they be. You can't be afraid of young players. This whole culture of being afraid of kids is one of the reasons why, as I was saying before the show, everything new sucks. Because we're afraid of kids. You know what? Grown-ups are supposed to tell kids what to do. Why? Because they're grown-ups and they know more things. Like, this isn't Ender's Game. Kids don't actually know way more about complex things like, say, NHL hockey or war with space bugs than adults. And honestly, Brian Burke and Ron Wilson, because they are so unlikable as people in many respects in the media, are never going to get the credit they deserve for literally taking a questionable top 10 pick who nearly was a bust and just forcing him to become a number one center, because that's what he is. Nazem Kadri is a number one center in the NHL right now, and it's all because of what Brian Burke and Ron Wilson did during his development.
Tell me if you guys disagree with this, but I think if we were seeing the same course of action with the staff the Flames had a couple years ago, we might have been questioning it more. But to me, I feel more comfortable that this is the right way forward because I believe the Flames have the right hockey staff in place. Between the coaching staff, between Feaster's office and Burke, I feel like we have a team of guys here who know what they're doing.
I think the last group did know what they were doing in a sense,
I think it was very unilateral, though.
It was, but I'll say it this way then. I think that if the staff last time did this to certain players, we'd probably view it as the right thing, maybe? I don't know. In the last regime, we really didn't have this caliber of talent to screw around with.
But think if the last regime, I guess, was still here and it was still being run by the same people.
Okay, no, but the last regime, are you talking about Feaster with Brent as coach or Daryl with Brent as coach?
But at the so let's go with the what was Daryl with Feaster as his assistant.
Okay,
which is how Feaster was brought now, in. Brent was coach. So if you had Daryl and Brent and Feaster, who essentially had this roster, were still in power and started sitting young guys, I think that we'd probably start to say, okay, Sutter's lost it again. What the hell's he doing?
Probably. Well, the thing is that how Sutter went about things, it was getting a little long in the tooth with him when towards the end, like when Feaster was brought on. And you know, like, the team was struggling quite a bit, so, like, you get a little bit more questionable about anything that he would do. Whereas with the current group, you know, the thing is that you got Wisebrod, who helped build the Bruins into a Cup winning team. You have Feaster, who won a cup in Tampa, and you have Burke, who won a cup in Anaheim. So you've got a group that obviously knows a bit of what to do right, you know, at, they should, you know, because they've been successful. So, you know, you're going to give them a little bit more leeway, where at the time, Brent and Daryl had not won a cup as a coach or manager or whatever. So, you know, it, you know, going with experts per se, you're a little bit more able to forgive anything versus someone who hasn't actually won anything at the time.
And I see where you're both coming from. I do think that if it had been, if Daryl had appeared to be more willing to do what everyone else viewed as the right thing, i.e. blow it up, then I think he would have been able to stick around. But because he was committed to his guys, which, you know, is what makes Daryl Daryl, and it's why he has success as a coach now.
I guess to me it's not necessarily just the Daryl thing. I guess I look at it as that was more of a unilateral reign. Today when I see this kind of thing happening, I say, you know what, like Matt said, we've got a bunch of guys here now who have all had success, and as a group, these experts, if you will, have decided this is the right thing to do. It's not just one guy. So I feel a little bit more confident that this is probably the right move, whatever that move is.
Well, I mean, all of our collective experience, I mean, and we forgot to mention Bob Hartley as a Stanley Cup ring as a coach, or did we? I don't know. Okay, you did mention it?
No, we did forget to.
Okay. That doesn't stop there being a, what, 500-post thread, is Bob Hartley the right coach for this team? Probably. I mean,
I think every fan, anytime that you're not having success, and anytime that you're not used to not having success, which, let's be honest, Flames fans probably aren't used to the team performing the way it is, are going to ask that question.
And I suppose that's fair, but I mean,
if we didn't question him, I don't think we would perhaps be doing our jobs as analysts of the team or as interested fans. I think you always have to ask, is this the right guy? You don't necessarily have to make a change, but I think you always have to ask that question. Is he the right guy to lead us forward?
For sure. Always be in like a state of constant evaluation, but don't get to the point where you're basically throwing fastballs at a catcher with no mitt.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah, and I think we have to look at him and have to evaluate, and because this is such a critical time in the team's development, if he's not the right guy, let's get him out before he does any damage. I think he's the right guy right now, but I think if it comes to the point where he's not, we have to be asking that question often so we can identify that early and make a change.
I think anyone who thinks that Bob Hartley is actually doing damage to anyone in the course of this rebuild is deluded.
Oh, I think he's doing a great job. Don't get me wrong. I don't think he's doing damage, but I'm just seeing some of what's been talked about. I think he's the guy. No, I think we've seen him motivate this team better than we've seen the Flames be motivated in years.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, Bob Hartley is a likable person.
Yeah, he seems like a nice guy. I've never met him, but he seems like a nice guy.
No, he just seems like someone you wouldn't hate coming to work with.
He seems like a down-to-earth guy. He doesn't, you know, there's a lot of NHL coaches I'd never want to play for. I guess if I had to think about it, yeah, I probably wouldn't mind playing for Hartley based on what I know about him.
Well, plus, I'm just going to throw something in. Plus, you know, like, if you get rid of Hartley, say, and you replace him with somebody else, well, what's the difference, really? Like, you know, even if you had Scotty Bowman in his prime, this team's still not going to be a playoff team. Like, there's not, you know, you can only get...
There's no super coach that can make us a playoff team.
So, what's your point? Like, he's not doing anything blatantly detrimental like, say, Joe Sacco was in Colorado last year. So, why? Why would you bother? Yeah. You know, like, you're just shuffling the deck chairs. Like, what's the point?
You need to have a coach that's a good coach to work with the young guys. I think he is. So let's keep him here, and let's, just like we want to keep a GM here to let them kind of see through their plan, let's let Bob Hartley have enough time to see his plan through.
Yeah, and let's look to the north and see how well hastily firing coaches after a year of underachieving when, again, Scotty Bowman circa 1991 wouldn't make that team a playoff team. Let's just see how that does and see if we want, like, wandering in the desert aimlessly for 5 years.
I'd rather not.
Exactly. So let Bob Hartley do his job. He's better at it than you.
I won't argue with that one.
Not any of you guys, but just...
Oh, he's probably better than me. I probably wouldn't do as good a job with this team.
No.
I'd probably be very starstruck.
Yeah, I think we all would. I think if you were on that bench with those assistant coaches, I'd probably say, you know what? You guys know what you're doing. I'll go sit in the dressing room in the hot tub. Have fun.
Yeah, that'd be a weird moment afterwards. Be like, you said in the interview process you had a system.
I do.
I didn't realize
it was a game system. You mean you're coaching from your Xbox? What the heck?
Yeah. B button, B button, B button.
Exactly. So guys, do you think we could all say that we're in agreement that we're seeing the Flames team we should be expecting this year?
Yeah, pretty much. You know, with only having two or three top six forwards, only two, maybe three top four guys, and no starting goaltender, even the Florida Panthers last year were a better team on paper heading into the season than the Flames are now. So, it's bad.
What do you think, Luke?
I think this is exactly what we were expecting. It's frankly, again, it's exactly what we've all been asking for the better part of 3 years. So now that we've actually got it, let's be patient and see it through.
We have the team we want, and I think we have the team we deserve right now. As a team going into the lockout or going into a rebuild, I think we've got a pretty good roster for a team in the first year of the rebuild. So yeah, let's give it some time. Let's see how this thing shakes out, and let's have confidence in all these great hockey guys.
And let's get excited about every 3 or 4 days, it seems, there's a new GIF circulating the internet of Johnny Gaudreau literally shape-shifting through opposing defenses and scoring a goal where you have to watch that play 5 or 6 times to understand exactly how the puck went in. Like, get excited about that, because that kid's going to be here by the end of the season.
Yeah, well, plus another worrying thing is that over the past 20 years with Canadian teams is that when they start going into a rebuild, the fans get pissed off. And, you know, like, they want everything here done, packaged today. We want to be in the playoffs. And that kind of limits your ability to actually win a cup, because if you rush things, you're not going to be bad enough to actually get the good picks that you need in order to get the good players that you need to actually win a cup with. So,
you know, we're going to do this, we have to be ready for the pain, and we have to do it right.
Like, it's going
to
suck. Like, it will suck for the next 2 years. But, you know, getting, say, Reinhardt or Dal Colley this year and possibly McDavid next year, like, you add those on top of guys like Poirier, Gaudreau, Monahan, on and on and on, like, you could actually see a cup-caliber team if you get that many good players on the team. So, you know, like, it sucks now, but, like, if we rush things and say we're picking 5th or 6th and get, say, Nylander and whomever next year, like, they're not going to necessarily be able to push us over the line where we can actually be a cup-winning team. So, you know, it sucks, but in the long run, it'll be better.
Yeah, we have a long-term plan that we have to see out for this team to be successful.
And realistically, with the forwards that we already have in the system, like, we have enough players that we should be able to flesh out a solid lineup even without the players that are coming. It takes time for guys like Knight and Granlund and all that to develop into NHL players, but we already got those guys in the system. So, you know, it's coming. It's just, you know, if you rush it, you might not get the stars that you need in order to, you know, because, like, we need our Taze and our Kane or our Crosby and Malkin, you know what I mean? Like, the star players. And, like, Monahan, while he's a very good player, you know, you need at least one or two guys that are that or better in order to push yourself over the line.
Yeah, and, you know, we will get there. We're just not there yet. So give it a couple years, see what the Flames do, and then let's cast judgment.
And look at it this way. You're probably not going to be dead by the time it, you know, turns around.
I hope not. You know, the positive that I'm taking away from this is I'm a hothouse member, so I'm hoping enough people get frustrated, I can finally get my tickets, so I'm there to see this team when they get good.
Yeah.
Although I will say this, there is a sort of, I don't know, maybe majesty is the wrong word, but I don't know about you guys, I'd never seen someone score 4 goals in person before, or have a 6-point night, and I saw that on Thursday.
Yeah.
It was surreal.
Actually rather cool. Yeah,
like, you know, you take the good and you take the bad. Like, and sometimes, like, it's not like we're going to the rink now just to see Sagan and Ben, but when they come in and they put on a show, you know.
Yeah, that's good.
Enjoy it. You're gonna tell your... Okay, if you're really boring, you'll tell your grandkids about this time that you saw a 6-point game between Dallas and Calgary in November of 2013.
Back when they used to wear helmets.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's true. I mean, and I think you might be right, Luke, in that we maybe have stopped looking at this as the Flames are disappointing us, and let's just go watch some really good hockey.
Well, to me, it's like, if you're disappointed in this team, it's like getting disappointed in a first grader who fails calculus.
Yeah, we all knew what to expect. The management told us what to expect coming into this year.
Yeah, why did you expect he was going to be able to do it?
I think we just perhaps got ourselves overinflated by the good start.
Mm-hmm. I suppose, but similarly, to stick with this, just because the kid knows his times tables doesn't mean that he's going to be able to figure out calculus things. I can't even come up with an example because I'm not smart enough to do calculus. So why are you expecting a 7-year-old to figure it out?
Yeah, let's just give it some time and see what happens there. You were talking about the great goals that we've been seeing from Johnny Hockey lately. Another prospect that's been doing really well is John Gillies, who actually became Providence College all-time shutouts leader on Saturday afternoon. Did either of you guys see any of that game online?
No.
No.
No, I was watching some of it. He looked... I mean, this guy looks fantastic. I've been watching some of the college games that, you know, people record on their smartphones and put online after. He's looking like a really good upcoming goalie.
Yeah, in July when I was at the development camp at Winsport, like, his glove and his blocker are both very good, and his ability to make kick saves and that is really good. His positioning is really good. The only weakness that he has is he's a little bit slow side to side, but, you know, not that bad. You know, it's about Luongo's caliber of speed across.
But for his age, he's got lots of time to fix that, too.
Yeah, exactly, and for somebody that's 19 to be doing that, like, that's absolutely ridiculous. And, like, I've watched a lot of goalies before they enter the NHL, and there's only been a handful that I've been this impressed with. So, you know, and, like, it was Ryan Miller, I think it was Lundqvist, and Frederick Anderson, the Ducks' new goalie. Like, I watched a bit of him when he was in Denmark still, and I thought he was going to be a really good one, and, well, he's off to a good start anyway. So, but, you know, he...
Lots of promise
very well
in the system.
Could be, yeah, like, he could be a top 5 goalie in the NHL if he keeps on this path. He really is that good.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to watching the World Juniors this year just so I can see John Gillies play against top competition.
Yeah, and I think it'll be good for his development to do that and for Flames fans to see it and get stoked about him.
Yeah, but and like I just ultimately like I don't really have the interest in watching bootleg cell phone videos of NCAA highlights. I feel like I'm in touch enough watching the Johnny Hockey GIFs, which is terrible, I know. But I just want to be able to, you know, sit back and just watch this dude play in proper HD and just see where he's at. Because
Not wrong at all.
When Risebrod said he was, you know, internally probably the organization's top-ranked prospect, I mean, that's not... You don't say that just to say it. That does mean something, and given how America's been turning out goalies lately, I can't wait.
Yeah, I think it'll be really interesting to see all these guys come up over the next couple of years.
Well, another thing with Gillies is that the Flames are trying to lure him away from college early, so we might even be able to see him next year. And at that development camp, like he, of all the goalies, which everybody except for Joey McDonald was there, like he was the best guy. So, you know, and even better than Berra, who's doing all right in the NHL right now. So, you know, like he could be the starter as soon as next year if he leaves college, which sounds ridiculous, but he really is that good.
Maybe he could pull a Carey Price. We need to hit on a goalie. Like, obviously we hit on Kiprusoff, but even that wasn't us. That was San Jose drafting someone. And frankly, Kiprusoff was drafted in 1995, or 1994. So 10 years after he was drafted, we get him, and he turns into the best goalie in the world. I'd love to hit on a goalie who was just 20 years old and could be the guy for the next 15, 20 years.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
It would be. Just continuity.
I'm trying to think the last goaltender the Flames drafted that made any sort of dent in the league was probably Trevor Kidd.
Yeah, and before that, Vernon. Like, it's been pathetic.
Is that it? The only two goalies outside of Kiprusoff that anyone outside of Calgary knows? Wow.
Yeah, we've had a pretty bad goaltending drafting time. So, but the thing is that we have to just keep, like, until, like, if Gillies doesn't pan out, like, we just need to keep adding goalies, because eventually one will hit.
And I think we've got a good crop right now.
Yeah. So, like, you know, getting rid of Brossoit, you know, like, if you add somebody through the draft this year, you know what I mean? Like, just keep going until you actually get somebody that's at least Kipper's level of good, and then you're good for a while.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, there's no reason not to take a flyer on a goalie at least every second year in, like, the third round or beyond. You know, just keep someone new blood in the system, something like that. But I don't know. I honestly, I would not be opposed at all to the Flames going out in the off season and throwing a decent sized offer at Jonas Hiller. We've got the money. Burke's familiar with him. It would help stabilize the goaltending position, and by the time that contract is over, Gillies would be in his mid 20s and probably a Schneider-esque part of his career, and he could just step in and be the guy and be completely ready, as opposed to heaping all the pressure of being the number one in a Canadian market on a 20-year-old kid.
Yeah, well, it also depends on how Berra and Ramo do the rest of the year as well, because you might not even need to go out and sign someone if one of those two guys steps in and at least is like an average NHL goalie. But if not, you got guys like, say, Montoya, Hiller, You know, I think you could get Brian Elliott for a song. So, you know, there's options. You can always get a 1B. So
for sure. I would say this, though. I'm rapidly running out of patience with Ramo.
Yeah.
He plays way too skittish to be a long-term NHL goalie. And Berra, you know, I really like Berra. I like what I see of him, as I think we've established. But if there's a situation where we can get a guy like Jonas Hiller, I think that is one of those moves. It's not a win-now move. It is a get-better-now move. And I'm all in favor of get-better-now moves.
Yeah, me too. And, you know, I think we have to probably agree Ramo is worth trying.
Oh, yeah. He was definitely worth trying.
Any of us can say the team did a bad thing by trying him. We tried him. We said, okay, maybe he's not the right guy, but it'll be how the team responds and if they can move on and say, you know what, you're right, let's cut the deal, let's, you know, do whatever we got to do to get him out of here and then move on and find someone else.
You have to throw as many darts at the board and hope one sticks. So, you know, it was a worthwhile effort. If he turns it around, good. If not, oh well, you tried.
Yeah, and his contract is such that there's no real hurry to get out from under it other than just to avoid paying him $2.75 million. But
gotta hit like, the floor, man.
Yeah, you do. Like, I remember reading something like that with the injuries we had at the start of the year to Stajan and Camilleri, we were actually a good $5 or $6 million under the floor, weren't we?
Yeah.
It wasn't close. And I was curious to know if, like, we were in violation of the CBA for doing that. But we obviously were well not under $48 million for a good 2-week stretch.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that if you don't put them on the IR and, like, get the cap deduction, then you're okay. Because they'll still be counting towards your cap even if you don't, you know, put them on the injured list.
All right.
So,
yeah. Well, I mean, the Flames have got people to look after that. But all I'm saying is, Burke, Feaster, if you're listening, if you can get Jonas Hiller, do it. He's a really good goalie. He has great masks.
If nothing else, at least you'll enjoy looking at his head when you're at the games, right?
Well, him and Berra both have good masks, so, you know, that'd be a good combo. At least you'd like looking at their masks, even if what they're doing on it, you know, in the crease is terrifying.
I find Berra's mask to just be okay. I don't find it to be a really great mask.
I like Berra's mask simply because it's very simple and there's like a nice color scheme and palette to it, and it's not super, like, there's no jaws, there's no teeth, there's no skulls, there's no creepy.
It's plain,
like,
it's simple, it's nice, you know, it seems like all the Swiss goalies have just really plain, simple, clean-looking, nice masks.
And, yeah. And if we get Jonas Hiller, we'll get a Jonas Hiller Movember mask. And I encourage everyone to look up his Anaheim Movember mask, which has every single member of the Ducks mustachioed. And I defy you to tell me that Corey Perry isn't rocking a Hitler. It's a full-on Adolf.
I'm really looking at this mask. Yeah, it's got all the guys like in Polaroid pictures on it.
Yeah. By the way, did you guys see Corey Perry steal Alexander Semin's stick?
Yeah, that was awesome.
That was terrific. What an asshole. But, like, just so delightful.
I know, and then Semin just sitting there like, what just happened, man? Where'd my stick go?
Yeah, I know. I saw the look on Semin's face, and you could tell he just had no idea what had just gone on.
Well, to be fair, would you?
No.
Like, that was so disrespectful. There was no reason for that. You just took my stick. I mean, I didn't pay for it, so I'm not that upset, but, like,
really?
Come on. How old are you, man?
Let's act like adults. We're playing in an adult league.
Yeah.
It was funny. I liked it.
I liked it as well.
Any other topics you guys want to chat about this week?
Nah, I'm good.
I'd just like to say that $8 plus for a Keith's is still overpriced. Yeah. Just figure that out, Saddle Dome. No, you won't.
Whatever. And all the beer at the Dome's overpriced.
I know.
I mean, $7 for a bud is way too much.
I suppose, yeah. I mean, like, okay, if it comes down to paying $8 for Keith's or $7 for a bud, I'm going to pay $8 for a Keith's. Yeah. In a heartbeat.
Yeah, I won't drink the bud when I'm there. So, guys, I want to ask you this question now that we've seen the third jerseys in action twice. Have your thoughts changed on them?
No, still terrible.
They're still forgettable. They look way too much like New Jersey jerseys. Yeah.
And with the pants being, you know, the regular jerseys, like, it just looks like a mess.
Well, you and I mentioned that after the show when we did our live broadcast from the event, is it's going to look awful with those pants, and I'm surprised they haven't just put a black shell over them.
Yeah, like, it'd look a lot better if they, you know, actually went to the expense of getting a shell for them. It looks stupid, and... You know, like, it's all about details, and, you know, they didn't go to that extent, I don't think, so it'll be forgotten in a couple of years when they go on to something new.
Well, keep in mind, as we're talking about details, this is the organization that, for all of last year... had a big 30-foot picture of Mike Camilleri in the concourse.
Wearing number 93.
Yep. And it's just like, he wore 13 before. You've surely got some file footage of him in that jersey wearing 13. So why is he wearing a 93? Why? Because you're lazy. Actually, and I'm sure that was really expensive to print, but...
Still.
Whatever. Yeah.
Yeah, it's attention to details. I mean, it means everything. And
it does.
It's, you know, it's, even though it's expensive to print, it's not like the Flames can't afford a new banner.
Exactly. They'd probably get it for, well, maybe not free, but I can't speak to this. Anyway.
Before we sign off tonight, next week is our big 30th episode. And to help celebrate that, we want to hear from everybody. We want to hear from you guys, our listeners, who've helped make the show what it is. Because without you, we wouldn't be here doing this show. So if you go to firesidechat.ca/feedback, we've actually set up a page where you can leave us your feedback. You can get a hold of us through Twitter, through Facebook. You can email us. There's an email form on that page. And even a Skype voicemail. And we just want to hear your thoughts on the current Flames, past Flames, maybe your favorite Flame of all time, where the team's going or who you're excited about seeing in the future. We even want to know about some of your favorite Flames memories. Maybe there's a player that you miss here, or a Flames memory that stands out, or even things about the podcast. Who's your favorite host? What was your favorite episode? Maybe you wish that we would have got Sven Barchi of Barbershop Quartet. So, chime in, let us hear your thoughts, and we're hoping that we can play them all on the air next week.
Yeah, and if not a Barbershop Quartet, at least a Kissogram.
If you want to get him a Kissogram, I'll let you put your name on the card for that by yourself.
Well, I mean, it's not. I'm not sending him a man. I'm sending him some lady who's working her way through nursing school or whatever. Right? Isn't that the story?
I'll still let you put your name on the card by yourself. So if you want to put your name on the card with Luke, you can get a hold of us at firesidechat.ca/feedback and let us know that. Maybe you have a better gift idea.
That's a Kickstarter. That's what that is. The Sven Barchi Kissogram Kickstarter.
There you go. Hook it up. We'll promote it next week if you get it going.
For sure. All right. This is going to be a thing. Let's do it.
Let's see how much money we can raise for Luke's Kissogram. Well, Luke, why don't you tell us that when you do set up the Kickstarter, where people can find you online so they can get information on it?
All right. I'm online on Twitter, at Luke1701. Please tweet me with ideas for how we can make this Kissogram thing happen. If anyone knows a young lady who'd be willing to dress up in a nurse's outfit and bring Sven a box of chocolates and like sing him a song or something. I don't know what Kissograms do beyond the obvious. Tweet me at Luke1701 and
And Matt, what about you if they want to get your live play-by-play coverage during away games?
At Caged Great on Twitter. I'm up to, I think, 36 Twitter followers now, so it's climbing slowly but surely, so...
Matt's got great content. I love to sit and watch what he's doing while I watch the game. My Twitter, before we get to the show, is at DG Stevenson, and I tweet a little bit about hockey, mostly about tech news, that sort of thing for my day job. But if you do want to follow the show, you can follow us on Twitter at Fireside Podcast, on Facebook, we're facebook.com/firesidechat, or you can subscribe to our show through iTunes or Stitcher, wherever the best podcasts are available. And feel free to come on our site, read some of the articles, leave a comment, and don't forget to sound off and be part of next week's show. Well, with that, I think we're done for the week, and we'll see everybody next week.
Have a good one.
Okay, a little bit of before we go, one more thing. We've literally been trying to wrap this show for 14 minutes. So, yeah.
Says the guy who keeps delaying it.
Yeah, I do. But, so, yeah. Well, suck it, Tom.
We are the boys of chorus. We hope you like our show. We know you're rooting for us, but now we have to go.
Fireside Chat Podcast, produced and edited by Dan Stevenson.